to another edition of Play It Through, and on this edition, it's Guerilla War, brought to us by SNK. A run-and-gun game similar to SNK's other series, Ikari Warriors, Guerilla War is also an arcade port. Another very interesting note, though, about Guerilla War is that the Japanese version is actually named Guevara, based on actually the revolutionary Che Guevara, and you actually play as him, and the second player actually plays as Fidel Castro, with the game taking place in the 1950s and showing the revolution of Che Guevara and Fidel Castro defeating the Batista regime and taking over Cuba. And just like many other run-and-gun games, the difficulty can get rather steep at times. However, to be honest, this is one of the best experiences on the NES for a run-and-gun game, as it doesn't have crippling difficulty such as SNK's Ikari Warriors. So here we go with Guerilla War for the NES. You can play Guerilla War one or two players. After selecting that, you get to see the short intro sequence of the boat arriving on the island, and our main hero jumping out, and then the game begins. As you can see, the graphics are actually pretty good, and it's really a lot of stuff going on screen at one time. However, the one thing I love about Guerilla War, and like I said earlier, is that it's not crippling, is that you actually usually have a few seconds to fight an enemy after they appear on screen, and you usually won't be hit by too many enemies off-screen. You have some nice breaks in between the firing of their weapons, and this gives you the opportunity to dodge and get in the correct shots that you want. One of the coolest parts about the game is being able to jump inside of a tank, being able to run over enemies, destroy them, and easily make it through parts of levels. Most normal enemies in the game are going to be taken out with a single shot of your gun, no matter which weapon you end up having. However, there are multiple different types of weapons you can get from the power-ups. The upgrades to your weapons not only changes your main weapon, but actually also changes the weapon you have inside the tank. Thankfully, you don't have to defeat all enemies on screen in order to continue, and one strategy, especially with the tank, is to just kind of run through a lot of them real quickly to get to less populated areas. Here we have the boss of the first level of the game. Get to the bottom of the screen and immediately start attacking, especially if you still have the tank. If you have the tank with the spread shot fire, you can actually just stand right in front of him and keep attacking. He'll never be able to hit you, and you actually should be able to take out all the soldiers that come out of the buildings to help him. Once he's taken out, the helicopter appears. This one's a little bit more tricky, and you'll have to actually dodge a lot of the fire. It shoots out a four-shot spread shot that goes out in multiple directions. It's actually not a bad attack to actually dodge, because the bullets move rather slow, and they dissipate after only a few seconds of being on screen. Once you fully take out the helicopter, we move on to stage number 2. The upgrades in the game are represented by the squares you find with the letters in them on the ground. The weapons are the laser, which is pretty much the most common one you're picking up. There's the shrapnel, which shoots a rocket, and then after the rocket explodes, it actually allows some stuff to come off of it, hitting enemies. There's the spread shot, which allows you to shoot in the V formation. There's, of course, the tank. And there's also a rapid fire one that allows you to just hold down the button, but it really isn't that powerful. And my personal favorite, the flamethrower. Well, I'm going to show all the weapons in the game. Easily the best one in my opinion is the flamethrower, as it shoots out a wave of death in front of it that takes out pretty much every enemy in front of you. While it may not be ethical, shooting a pig with a rocket in the game actually grants you 1,000 bonus points. Also, pretty much killing any animal in the game will net you some bonus points as well. The only thing that really hurts you is when you take out hostages. Now, the hostages end up giving you a negative 500 per kill, or if you save them, you get a plus 1000 to your score. However, besides the score, there is no other effect to the game. There isn't a different ending if you save all the hostages. After you pass these clotheslines, it's time for the mini-boss of the stage. Attack with the tank from the left side, and then go up to the top of the screen. If he'll go down, you can just keep blasting him from behind. It only takes a few shots to take him out, and it's actually a pretty easy battle because he goes so far low, there's really no way of him hitting you unless you decide to stay at the very bottom of the screen. Run up here, we get to save a nurse as well as a hostage, and then we continue blowing through all the lines of troops as we make our way up. As we make our way past this well, it's time for the next boss fight. Stay just a little bit past halfway down the screen from him, and he won't be able to hit you with the bombs he throws out. When he gets near the bottom of the screen, go past him and head to the top of the screen, continuing firing at him below. He won't be able to hit you if you're at the very, very top of the screen, so be careful when you turn around to fire at him. After you're able to deliver a good amount of shots to him, he explodes and we move on to stage number 3. Besides just your normal fire though, you also have grenades you can throw out to take out enemies in bunches. Be very careful in a small area if you have enemies below you and above you, because that's pretty much the best opportunity for the enemy to corner you and get those shots in on you. When playing through a lot of these types of games and you get a lot of enemies on screen, it's a consistent slowdown, but I actually find in Guerilla War the slowdown isn't too distracting and it's not very bad, considering how many enemies and projectiles are on screen at the same time. Be careful of this enemy below you on the shoreline as you're trying to make your way through the water, taking out the enemies that are underneath. Thankfully, you can easily see where an enemy is in the water itself, so you can hit them with your weapon. Also, be very careful if you see a square on the ground that's flashing different colors. That's a landmine, which ends up being an instant death if you end up landing on it. Be careful at that part where a whole bunch of enemies jump out of the water at once. However, they don't seem to fire very quickly, so you have plenty of time to get past them. You like to do this a lot, and as you can see, when there's a lot of enemies on screen, the slowdown takes effect. You really get a big advantage because there's less projectiles that are going to be coming out, or the projectiles that are out are going to be moving a lot slower and easier to dodge. Watch out for these boat enemies and ride the coastline in order to get up past the boat so you don't have to really deal with them one-on-one. Here, I grabbed the flame weapon for the first real time, and this is my favorite weapon like I mentioned before, and it's definitely handy coming up here as we make it to the boss battle of the stage. Stand near the bottom of the screen and use your flame to actually just go straight up in a line and take out all the enemies directly in front of you. After a little bit, you may have to move over to the left or right side in order to take out some of the other enemies that appear, but taking out ones just down the middle is usually enough in order to actually beat the boss. As you can see, after an enemy fires for a certain amount of time, a lot of them just jump off screen. However, the ones that are persistent, you will have to take out in order to actually complete the stage. After you fight a lot of the green soldiers, you instead have to start fighting some of the yellow soldiers, but with our upgraded flame weapon, they're definitely no match and they get taken out with a single shot as well. After killing a lot of the yellow soldiers, a red soldier will appear. This is the one we have to get rid of so we can actually get to the real boss of this stage. Watch out for his 3 or 4 shot spread shot, and just keep pegging him with all your flamethrower or whatever weapon you prefer. You can also throw grenades, but they're pretty easy to dodge as well. For this boss, stand exactly where I'm standing, you'll be able to fire directly upwards, easily taking out the guy, and he won't be able to hit you with any of his missiles. Then, pretty much stand in a similar position on the next boss, and you'll be able to dodge all his missiles as well, and we can finally complete this stage. At the beginning of the next level, watch out for the helicopters, as two of them appear right away from the left side of the screen. Thankfully, after just a few barricades, you'll be able to jump into a tank to really start destroying some of these enemies. As you can see, the tank can also use the flamethrower weapon, and it comes in real handy being able to wipe out a lot of enemies in a row. Once you're inside the tank, it's really easy to just be able to get past a lot of enemies, so unless you're really trying to get the highest score possible, just run past a large amount of the enemies, especially in large bunches, and really only focus on destroying the ones that are directly in front of you. Be very careful while moving along this bridge, as you'll have tanks and some helicopters. The tanks are quite weird, as after you hit them once with a flamethrower, they start spinning sporadically, firing in all different directions. So just stay from a good distance away, and then actually hit them again with the flamethrower to get rid of them. This whole area is actually pretty tight because of the mountains to the left and to the right, so you have to be very careful while making it up in the smaller area since the bullets have a much better chance of getting to you. If you've lost your tank ability by this point, it's best just to take it very slowly and just inch your way forward, taking out the enemies as you possibly can. Be careful crossing over this bridge because there is a helicopter from the right side, as well as a large amount of soldiers trying to get to you. Use the barricades to your advantage, and especially with the flamethrower weapon, as you can easily hit over it. Watch out for some landmines located here, you'll have to go in between them and walk your way around slowly. Here we have our boss battle for the stage. Start off in the middle of the screen and fire a few times at your weapon to hit it before it comes out of the tunnel full. After throwing out a round of grenades, it'll then move to the bottom of the screen. If you stand in the right spot during this fight, you'll be able to avoid the grenades as they're flying out of him, and also be able to avoid the explosion they leave behind. While the boss can take a lot of damage, it moves so slowly and only has one type of fire that it ends up not being such a bad battle. After you defeat the boss, however, the two big guys end up jumping out of the machine itself, and one of them picks you up and launches you to the next level. After being launched into the next level, we're inside of a minecart, and this is probably one of the cooler parts of the game. Inside the minecart, you can actually use a whip in order to hit enemies on the left and right sides of the screen. While this level really isn't a bonus stage, it can really be perceived as such. And definitely the effect of how the track turns you and turns the screen as well is pretty cool for an NES game. Thank you. breach this barrier, the minecart ends up exploding, and you actually now get into the actual main battle part of the stage. Watch out for the enemies in the trenches throwing you some grenades, and be careful not to accidentally pick up an upgrade you don't want. There seems to be a lot of upgrades dropped at that part of the screen. When you make it up here, it's time for another boss fight against the giant train. Start at the top of the screen firing at it, and then move around in a circular pattern down to the south. After a while, it will shoot out a few soldiers for you to take care of as well, but they're easily dispensed with just a single shot. Thankfully, the machine gun fire of the train itself can only go so far on screen, so as long as you stay above it, you shouldn't be able to get hit. After the train's destroyed, we move on to the next level. As we've exited the jungle and come out of the mines, we're now in actually the city part of the game. While nothing really changes as far as a lot of the enemies are concerned, it is a nice change of background at least. Be careful though, because there are open manhole covers, and enemies will jump out of that 3 or 4 at a time. When you make it here, you won't be able to continue going straight because of the barrier. Instead, you'll have to go over to the right and start going down a different alleyway. Just like a few seconds before, we reach another barrier, and now we get to go back to the left side. Just be very careful as soon as you get over here, as there's landmines and a tank waiting to attack you. With the large amount of barriers, the flamethrower comes in handy huge here, as it's able to just go right over the barriers with its attack. During the section, there's a ton of tanks and no real normal soldiers. Go slowly and watch out though, because the missiles these tanks fire out go across the entire length of the screen, but thankfully they can only be shot in a few different directions. When you make it up top here, you'll be grabbed by another one of those guys from earlier and be launched now into the next level. The next level is inside the sewers, and this is one of the tougher stages in my opinion. You have a lot of water you can walk through, which does slow you down a bit as it did in the river level that we had earlier in the game, and it just seems to be a lot more enemies in a condensed space during this stage, but that could just be me. These tight turns can be a little bit of a problem because it's hard to see enemies coming at you directly from the left side, so you have to be very careful and inch your way over so that an enemy doesn't just spawn and end up catching you by surprise. Throughout this stage as well, there will be little rats that run across the ground, and if you're able to take them out, you get 1,000 bonus points for each one. When you make it up here on the left side, you'll see there's a whole row of guys with bazookas, so be very careful and aim diagonally with your shot so you can take them out before having to walk directly in line with their fire. The boss for the level is actually just a giant gauntlet against a ton of soldiers. Thankfully, if you lose a life during this, you can get some extra power-ups as soon as you come back by defeating the red soldiers that appear. Since no enemy spawns directly at the very bottom of the screen, that's a good place for you to hang out and take out the enemies as they come at you. Unfortunately, right there I end up losing a life, but thankfully I can immediately pick up my power-up right again and also get another extra life in the process. It'll seem like a complete endless stream of guys, but eventually, after defeating enough of them, you'll be able to move on to the next level of the game. The next level, we're once again back in the streets of Havana. Continue working your way up, watching out for once again sewer enemies, as well as a decent amount of landmines that are laying around. Also, just like before, you'll have to go between the left and right side of the screen when you reach a barrier. Be careful here because the enemies on the rooftops are a little bit tough to get to, and they easily can hit you with a bazooka shot. During this stage, there is a ton of helicopter enemies that are going to try to attack you from the left and right sides of the screen. Thankfully, they don't seem to fire very much, if at all, and they go off stream rather quickly as well, so they aren't too much of a threat, just be careful not to accidentally run into them. As the area opens up, it's time for the boss battle of the stage. Get to the top of the screen and fire a few times at the giant tank. It shoots out 4 missiles at a time, going out in a spread formation. Just get in between either the far left or far right ones so you can avoid getting hit altogether. Stay a good distance away so you have a much better chance of being able to get in between the shots or avoiding them altogether. This guy can definitely be tough, especially because of his speed, but once you're able to take him out, we move on to the next level, the second to last level of the game. In the final level of the game, there is a lot of stuff in your way during this stage. Be very careful going in and out of all the barricades so you don't accidentally get stuck and hit by one of the projectiles from one of those enemies. Up here, you'll have to take out this truck when it appears after a few enemies jump out of it before you'll be able to continue moving through the level. With this being one of the final levels of the game, they're throwing everything at you, especially these tanks. The tanks have pretty good movement and they're coming out of nowhere at times, so be very careful while walking through, especially the later part of this level. Watch out for a huge amount of tanks along this runway and get ready for another boss fight. While this fight looks like a rematch, it's actually a little bit tougher as the movement of the vehicle as well as the amount of missiles it can fire out is definitely improved from the first time around. Attack him from behind for as long as you can as you won't be able to get hit by the missiles. When he goes back to the top of the screen, watch out to the far right and then go below him and move to the far left, going back and forth from the right to left side of the screen depending upon where he is. Once he's about 2 or 3 moves down, go behind him and that's your best opportunity to deliver enough hits. Once he's taken care of though, you've destroyed the base and now it's time for the actual final level of the game, the compound. Work your way up here collecting some hostages along the way for some bonus points before you get to a large army that starts attacking you. For the beginning portion of the section, while it's mainly just the green soldiers, stay in the middle of the screen and just go north straight. This will allow you to dodge almost all the missile fire from the soldiers and walk in between them with all the tanks. However, once a tank is directly in your way, move slightly over to the right and then be very careful because there's a large amount of blue soldiers attacking you and they move quickly. Also, the tanks can also follow you up into this big area, so also work on taking them out before continuing on. Now it's time for the mini-boss of the level. There's 4 of these gunners set up, all firing missiles at the same time to you. Just dodge back and forth to the left and right sides of the screen, firing when you can, slowly draining the health of each one. Thankfully, once you destroy one of them, it definitely gets easier. Destroying, of course, 2 will make it even easier, and then you can just really focus down on the last 2. You want to do your absolute best, though, not to get hit, because we have the final boss coming up right after this, and we want to conserve our lives, as well as our power-ups. Now it's time for the final boss of the game, the Dictator. He has 4 of the missile launchers we just faced up on top. However, only really 2 or 3 of them can appear on the screen at once, and the other one won't fire if it's off-screen. Work on moving back and forth, taking out them at first. Ignore him for now, and just focus on taking out those missile launchers. Of course, if you get a good opportunity and destroy one side completely of the missile launchers, and he comes over, you can definitely get in some good hits. However, once he dances over back to the right side of the screen, go and follow him there and try to take out some more of the missile launchers until he goes back to the left. After you've destroyed all the missile launchers though, he starts throwing out bombs as well as missiles of his own. Focus more on dodging his actual attacks, moving back and forth slowly, and only go for an attack when you have a big opportunity to do so. He does have a lot of health, however, you have a decent distance between yourself and him, so you can actually move out of the way to the left or right of all his giant projectiles. Once you finally take care of him though, you can sit back and enjoy the ending to Guerilla War. During the credits, we get to see a lot of the enemies and other characters we saw throughout the game, including this right here, where one of those hostages is chasing down a nurse. However, when he gets over to the right side of the screen, she explodes and ends up turning into a pig and starts chasing him down. Pretty much completely random, but I always get a good chuckle while watching the credits during that part. Then we come to our end screen where we get to see the beret we wore, as well as some bullets and a grenade sitting on the ground. Like I mentioned before, Guerilla War is easily one of my favorite run-and-gun games available for the NES, and it's a good one to start with, actually. While definitely not nearly as tough as other games such as Ikari Warriors, this gives you a good, ample opportunity to practice your dodging skills so you can take on games such as that. And with that, that's going to wrap up this edition of Play It Through. I'd like to thank you for watching, and of course, I hope you enjoyed.